Good morning, gang. Here we are again for another session. Let's get to the chat here. Let's move it on down here. Move it on down where we can see it. Move it over here into its proper posiciones. There we go. Now, today, say Robert, today we continue our story telling techniques. Storytelling techniques involving figurative writing. Figurative writing. Boom. All right. And we're going to wait for a few more people maybe to come on board. And while we're doing that, we can review what we mean by symbolic writing. A symbol is a figure of speech is any word or phrase that means something other than its literal meaning, okay? And we use, Hungry Years. Oh, I actually wrote a song called Hungry Years in Breakaway. What are you doing? Mr. Stevens, you know these things. What's going on? Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh, my God, Robert. I think I've known you for many years. Were you at the last meeting and maybe some before that as well. Any rate, wow. It's good to finally figure out, who you are. I don't know why I didn't figure it out before. But at any rate, hello. Nina, good to have you on board as well. Thanks for showing up for the veterans songwriting discussiones. All right. Every Tuesday and Friday we talk about songs, and we talk about what's great about them and what's working for them. And today we're gonna discuss several songs that have symbols that are that actually have symbols in the title. We already did on Tuesday we did Bullet Holes in the Sky, which I thought was a very interesting symbol song. In that, the interesting part is that the only symbol is Mike. Hey, Mike. How you doing? Glad to have you here. Bullet Holes in the Sky didn't talk about, like bullets and rifles and guns, and didn't use the sky, didn't have any support words that were supporting the symbolic title. The symbol was used once. And once only, the rest of the song was pretty literal, it talked about God and angels, but that has nothing to do with bullet holes in the sky, does it? I mean, the sky, I guess that's very vague, very vaguely connects. But we're going to show you some songs, at least one song that connects very much, that supports, that has a lot of symbolic support for the symbolic title. And you're going to be just freaked out, actually, because we're going to do the song The River by by Garth Brooks. But before we do that, I just wanted to go over the fact that that when you support a symbol, let's just say I'm going to write a song called "The River of Love," okay? Love is a river, river of love. Now, I have a choice here. When I set up a symbolic title, I have a choice to either stay in the symbolic world or be in the literal world and only use this river of love as a way to express myself in this real story. So in other words, I can say, you know, I've always loved you. You've been my best friend. You've been my lover. I can see this relationship lasting forever. I would call this a river of love. Okay, you see, there was literal writing, literal writing. And then finally, I use the symbol to make my point as big or bigger than I, you know, bigger than literal. That's the one thing about, well, one of the things about symbolic writing is that it creates massive amounts of emotion, usually through an image. And that's why I love to use symbols, because they do that. They do two things. They give you an image and they give you an emotion attached to that image, like river of love. So we picture a river and then we see the love. So it's, you get the imagery. And as we know, in songwriting and in storytelling in general, images are fantastic. You know, they really help our song maintain interest. And that's what we're all about in the songwriting world, is keeping the listener glued to the song till the very end. So we want to start out with something that gets you interested. We want to develop that idea. And then we want to close it with a nice, with a good, strong closure, right? Okay. Now, "Bullet Hole in the Sky" is an example of a song that stays literal, completely literal, until it finally gets to the point that he wants to make. And the point in the heavens, I'll read you just the last two lines of the chorus. It goes, "But I believe in God and country and in angels up on high, and in heaven shining down on us through bullet holes in the sky." Now, this was written by Mary Gaucher, spelled Gauthier. So it looks like Gauthier, but it's actually French and it's pronounced Gaucher. And she did an amazing album, which I'll show you once again. Why not? I mean, she's a brilliant genius, so why not show this again? She did this album with vets and relatives and friends of vets, spouses of vets. And this was one of the songs on that. We had another song also that we were going to look at, but I think today I want to stay in the world of symbols, so we're going to just talk about this song briefly, then we're going to move on to the first song we're going to do today through complete is the song called "Tunnel of Love" by The Boss. You guessed it. Bruce Springsteen. Okay. So if you want to be looking for that lyric online, just type in "Tunnel of Love" lyrics and kablinga bloom, they come right up. And when you get those up, make sure you click on the little, very vague little arrow. It's shaped like this, kind of at the bottom of the lyric. And that will open up the entire lyric for you, right? So we're going to talk about "Tunnel of Love" first. So go and fetch that here. I'll put that down here on the chat here. So get the lyric. "Tunnel of Love." All right, there we go. That's for people that sign up a little bit later, that come in a little later. They might know where to go. I'm still blown away that you know the song Hungry Years and Breakaway. Man, that goes back. That goes back so far. I'm freaked out. I'm freaked out right now. So we have a choice when we're going to use a symbolic title. We have a choice to just use it once and keep the song in the real world, in the world of physical writing, or we can go into the world and support it with the symbols. So when I use the example like a river of love, I could say, you know, this love flows through troubled times. So flowing fits with river, right? Now here's the deal when you start using symbolic support for a symbolic title. There is a little issue that comes up. And the issue is believability and melodrama. We don't want melodrama, and we don't want to get out of the song and get into the place of disbelief, where we're going, oh man, that's so corny. I know I don't buy into that. I just don't buy into it, okay? So we just have to watch out for that. So when you're using symbolic support for the symbolic title, just be careful that you don't overuse it. And also be careful that it fits the symbol. So if I say love is a river, I don't want to say driving down the road of life. Okay? No. That did not work. Okay? And I want to find out. That's called a mixed metaphor. Hey! Hi to 2-3. Thanks for coming on board. Good to see you. All right. So we don't want mixed metaphor, right? No, we do not. So let us now let's listen to our first song. Tunnel of Love, Bruce Springsteen. Let me get my Spotify. I think I've already lined it up on Spotify here. We go to Story Songs. And we go down here. Tunnel of Love. There it is. All right. This is, by the way, my very favorite Bruce Springsteen album. I love this album so much. Followed very closely behind by Devils and Dust and Born in the USA. Great, great, great albums. I love those albums. Oh, wait. I just realized. Hold on. I've got to turn on my speakers. Let me pause that and bring it back. Let me turn on my speakers here. Here we go. Let them warm up just a second. And now we should have music. Let's see. Tunnel of Love, Bruce Springsteen. Get the lyric.
Takes money from my hand while I was out.
All right. Woo! What a powerful, powerful song that is. Oh my God. That song just blows me away. I mean, brilliantly written. And I love the production. I love the sound of the instrumentation. The whole thing is just absolute perfection. Absolute perfection. Okay, now. Wow. Okay, so let's first of all talk about the basic prosody of the song. When bam, bam. Let's just listen to the opening of this song again, and let's just see where the song's going. We have carnival sounds, kind of synthetic as they are, and of course, because we're Bruce Springsteen, we can stretch out the intro. Okay, now, we haven't even gotten into this song yet. No lyrics yet. And already, he has set the stage so perfectly for what's about to happen, lyrically. Right? So we start with the which kind of reminds you of carnival-y kinds of happy, go-lucky sounds, you know, walking through the fairgrounds, and then suddenly that massive amount of contrast, and we have this sustained organ and synth, which makes everything very eerie, extremely eerie. That massive contrast. Remember, what we have to work with, our basic tools as songwriters, besides of course our creative genius, which I call our spark. Right? When we're on, when we're happening, when we're in the groove, when we're in the moment, we have what I like to call spark. Whereas just things are just sparking and flowing, just like, you know, oh wow, you know, it's just things are happening. So we have spark. But the tools that we have to use after we get that spark and we get stuff on paper, what we have and on our tape recorders and our our iPhones and stuff. What we have to work with is unique details. All three of these things create interest. And, you know, we want to create interest. We want the arc of interest to keep rising throughout the song, right? So what we have is unique detail, and we sprinkle that in with generic detail. Not every single word needs to be unique, but we want to sprinkle the uniqueness in there, right? Very important. Unique details create images which create interest, right? And we don't want to forget the five senses, right? Don't forget all the senses. See, hear, touch, taste, and whatever the fifth one is. See? Did I say that? See, hear, touch, taste, feel. Anyway, the five senses. We don't want to overlook all five of them, right? Sight. Okay. Yeah, seeing, sight. Anyway, not important. We know the five senses, and you don't want to overlook them. It's always good to get, you know, like you can get conversations in a song. You can get the smell of mama's stew, the taste of it, the touch of your pet kitty cat in your lap, you know, the softness of the fur, and hearing, you know, that's probably the one that I'm missing, is you can hear something in the distance, right? Because we have a tendency to use visual, like sight, as our only sense in songwriting. So keep those five senses in mind when you're writing. It will really help. Okay. So we have unique detail, we have contrast, and we can contrast in every single element of songwriting. We can contrast form, we can contrast settings. We can contrast time. We can contrast characters. One minute they can be one way, and the next minute they can be another. So we can have that contrast with characters. We can have contrast in line rhythm, in the length of our lines. So we can set up, it's about setting up expectations and either delivering what the listener expects or giving them what I like to call a tiny surprise, right? Charles John Quarto talked to me about tiny surprises, right? He's a poet and a lyricist and a genius. An amazing guy, amazing guy. If you ever run into a Charles John Quarto lyric, you will be forever delighted by his magic as a lyricist. Okay, so we have contrast in all the things, contrast in rhyme scheme, contrast in texture, right? Contrast in melodies, contrast in chord structure. So there's all these contrasts. We set up an expectation, we either give them what they want or we give them a little surprise. And that surprise is contrast. Also, we have opposites in any one of those things I've mentioned. Opposites of something is considered a form of contrast, right? So we have contrast. So details, contrast, and repetition. Yes, repetition when used properly, and also contrast when it's used properly, creates interest, and it highlights, doesn't it? So if I'm going to do this thing, I love you, yes I do. Think about you all the time. Now, that's pretty generic, right? But if I go, I love you, 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 for all of time. Whoa, okay, you see what I mean? It turns that normally fairly generic expression, I love you, into, you know, something that's very, very important. And of course, I love you, 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 I love you. That's all I want to say. You know, the Beatles song. Yeah, they used I love you, I love you. So repetition is a very powerful tool. And I know some of you are asking me right now, you're saying, well, when do you use contrast and when do you use repetition? How do I know when to use it? That is what I call in your development of your PI levels, professional intuition, PI. And we can advance those levels of professional intuition. It's all intuitive. It's all intuitive. And the way you get better at this professional intuition is to listen to a lot of songs that you love. Download the lyrics, analyze the lyrics, analyze the melody, and play the song if you want. You know, play it on your guitar. Learn the chords of the song. These are all the songs that you love are literally are a university class in great songwriting. Okay, all these songs, they will teach you. They will be your teacher. They will teach you how to do all this. The next thing you can do is to read great literature and poetry along with your trash novels, 50 Shades of Chartreuse. You can also read The Pony by John Steinbeck, or East of Eden by John Steinbeck. You can read No Country for Old Men by Cormac McCarthy. I mean, jeez, whoa. So there's great writers out there, and there's great poets. Mary Oliver, Emily Dickinson. These are all, like, it's great to fill your what I like to call your deep well, fill your deep well with great melodies, great chords, and great words. And there's nothing like reading great literature to help you be a better writer. You absorb it into your DNA, and it's quietly stashed in there. So when you want to write a great lyric, you have these secret, hidden, unconscious references, right? Always good to have. And the third thing you can do is you can write creatively every day. Sit down and do a timed write. Just start writing for, I would say, 10 to 15 minutes. Time it, turn the timer on, and just start writing on a topic that might interest you. You can write without a topic if you want, but you can pick a topic. There's an infinite number of topics, and the topics can be either emotional, conceptual, like love, power, money, or you can pick an event or an object. You can pick like Christmas 1983. That might have been a very memorable Christmas for you. You can write about that. Or you can write about my favorite old beat-up cowboy boots. You can write about that. Or my motorcycle. Or my fishing rod that Daddy gave me. Right? You can pick an object. So you can do all these things. You should do it every day. Every single day, at least 15 minutes a day, so that you feel your creative powers every day. And I also recommend that you do it early in the day, preferably maybe after you've just woken up and you make your first cup of coffee. That's my darling bride in the background talking to someone passing us by in the hallway. So we can write creatively every day. Of course, write a song. Okay, yeah, you write a song every day if you want to do that. And another challenge, just seeing as how we're on a little sidebar here, but this is all about songwriting, so sidebars about songwriting are okay, all right? We can challenge ourselves to write an entire song in 30 minutes, the 30-minute song, which I do with my class, which I used to hold for veterans at Blair School of Music at Vanderbilt. And we were also going to start one at MTSU, which is Middle Tennessee State. Middle Tennessee State University. MTSU. So hopefully we'll have some students this fall and we can do it possibly on Zoom. At any rate, so you can write creatively every day. At least 15 minutes, get that feeling in your blood. Just feel the power of your creative process every day. Take the weekends off. Monday through Friday, do it. And then refill your well. Refill the well on Saturday and Sunday. Enjoy life. Enjoy life to the maximum. And then back on it Monday. Do your creative writing every morning. Now, the last thing you want to do is you want to get critique from an expert at whatever you're doing. So if you're writing country music, you want to get critique on your country songs from someone who writes country music. This is important because if you get critique from an LA pop writer, they're not necessarily going to understand the nuances of country music. Country and pop, just to give two examples, are completely and separate, totally different languages. It's like learning French and Spanish. They're similar, but they're not the same. And so if you're going to get a critique on a country song, make sure you get a country person that's written country songs. Same thing with pop, same thing with bluegrass or reggae or whatever, right? Pick someone that, you know, knows the stuff, knows the genre, and can tell you what's good about your song and what could change to make it better, right? Yes, I do that. I do. So if any of you out there are interested in getting your songs critiqued, you can get in touch with me through CreatiVets.org. Just go to CreatiVets and talk to whoever's there. There's two people there. There's Brett and there's, I want to say, is it Eric? I apologize again. I'm having a brain fart. But the kind folks that dedicate their lives to this wonderful channel, creativevets.org, they're there to help you. And if you want to get in touch with me to critique a song, you can do that through them, and they'll get in touch with me, and I will get back in touch with you. And I would love to work with you on your songs. Okay, where are we? All right, so those are the things you can do to increase your PI levels, because the initial question was, when do you use repetition, when do you use contrast, and when do you use unique details? Well, every creative moment is unique and new and different. So I could never, ever tell you how much to use of any one of those three elements, right? But as the song unfolds, you can feel the energy of, oh, I need detail here. Oh, I think we've done enough of the same thing. Let's contrast a little bit. Let's change up the rhyme scheme. Let's change up the line length a little bit. So, to give you an example, if we're going along like da 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 da. I'm starting to get bored just with the line length. So we could do something like this. We give them an expectation. See how I did that? I changed it up, right? A little expected, and then suddenly a little unexpected. You've got their interest, right? You've given them something they can expect, and they can groove into it, and then boom, change it up a little bit. Just a little. Don't have to change it a lot. Just a little. Bing-a-da-bing. Ah, great. That's it, right? And again, it's all intuitive. It's intuitive. And you can learn this intuition by, like I said, by downloading lyrics of your favorite songs. And I recommend, you know, mixing it up. Like, I would go, as a songwriter, I always listen to the contemporary songs that are being played on the radio now. I listen to those and, you know, check them out, see how they're doing, what kind of melodies and chords they're using, and what kind of phrasing and so forth. But I also like to go back to Hank Williams, you know, and Hank Snow, and for country, of course, and, you know, and the greats, you know, Dolly Parton, some of her early stuff, and Loretta Lynn. There's great things to learn from those too, and yes, I love Bob Marley, reggae, you know, absolutely, get some reggae in there. Would I do some Bill Monroe? You bet your life I would, right? See what's going over there in the bluegrass field. So what I'm saying is you can mix it up. Because all those songs that I just mentioned, all those artists, are people that I love. James Taylor, Joni Mitchell, The Boss, you know, Bruce Springsteen, right? Buddy Holly, The Beach Boys, The Beatles, The Rolling Stones. The list goes on and on and on and on, you know. Rodney Crowell, oh my God, Rodney Crowell. Angels created that man for us to enjoy. He's one of my very, very, very favorite artists of all time. Anyway, so I listen and learn those songs, and that's like my lesson, my master class in songwriting, right? It will not fail you. If you study these songs, study the line length, study the rhyme scheme, study the lyrics, study the melody and the chords, you're going to pick it all up and learn. It's fantastic, right? Okay, back to Tunnel of Love. Got sidebarred, sidetracked there, but it was an important sidetrack, so let us keep going, all right? Okay, let's listen to the first verse and let's talk about that. First of all, can we talk about the form? The form of the song, was there a chorus? No, there was not a chorus, right? Not a chorus. Well, that's weird. I thought all songs had choruses. Well, yeah. Today, most every song has a chorus. It's just a thing, right? We're into the chorus era. But there was many decades where the dominant form was non-chorus form, where you had a verse, a bridge, which is different melodically and rhythmically than the verses, and then another verse to close. And that's a very standard. It could be verse, bridge, close. It can be just verse with no bridge. It can also be verse, bridge, verse, different kind of bridge, right? And I can show you one of those songs later in our ongoing quest for magic and wonderfulness. I'll actually write that down. So CreatiVets. We want to look at an A, B, A, C, A song. All right? One of my very, very, very favorite artists, Sting, wrote a song that I know you out there in vet land and I in vet room would love to have 1% of the money generated from the song Every Breath You Take. Oh yeah. Anyway, song made millions and billions and trillions of dollars, and you know, what's his name? One of the very early Eagles that wrote "Taking It Easy." It's not Trom. Anyway, he said, "Hey." Once the faucet turned on, it never turned off, right? Once you have one of those big, big hits, it gets on the oldies lists and it just keeps generating income year after year after year. Oh, anyway, we'll talk about that song on a future. Yeah, royalties forever. Exactly. Yeah. Now, it wasn't Jackson Browne. It was the guy. It was the guy. It sounds like Trump, but that's not it. It's the guy that he was in the Eagles for a short time, and then he dropped out. And I think Joe Walsh took his place. Anyway, it's not important. But he said, you know, he left the Eagles, but he did write that one song, and so he said. Man, once the faucet turned on, it never turned off. So he's still just making his royalty checks every quarter are just massive. Because he wrote Peaceful Easy Feeling or Taking It Easy. He wrote one of those two songs. And I never remember exactly. Donate, yes, donate to Creative Vets. Absolutely. Royalties forever. Woo, man. Anyway, back to Tunnel of Love. Let's listen to this. So it's a non-chorus song, meaning a non-chorus song, you either begin the verse with the title and or you end the verse with the title, right? That's the trick. And you can start it and end it. You can do both, right? But in this case, he just ends it. So let's listen to this spooky song that he set up. With the synth and everything, and we already know that it's a dark song, right? We already know the color of this song. is dark.
That man sitting on a little stool takes some money from my hand while his eyes take a walk all over the east.
Whoa. So what do we got here? The title of the song is Tunnel of Love. We hear the title on the last line, right? So right away we know. Now, you can have a chorus song where you put the title in the verse also. You can do that. I mean, there could have been a, you know, it's this key. Da, 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 da. As we ride down, baby, into this tunnel of love. So he could have gone in this tunnel. You know, he could have made a chorus out of it, but no, didn't want to make a chorus out of it. And again, you're in a creative moment. You decide in your wisdom, you know, I just don't feel chorusy today. I just feel like I'm going to make my point without the need of a repetition. As it turns out, he's got a lot to say. So, and we're going to get into that because it's very interesting what goes on and as the song progresses. So we have a story here, don't we? We have a snapshot. This is a situational plot, right? Where we're in one location and this thing is taking place as the song progresses. We're in the now. We're not going to step outside this one location and this one thing. So, fat man sitting on a little stool. Already, do you see what's going on there? Do you see what's going on? Fat man sitting on a little stool. What's happening there? Contrast. Opening line. He sets up some contrast. Fat and little. Opposites, right? Fat man sitting on a little stool takes the money from my hand while his eyes take a walk all over you. Now, whoa. Let's just say if I said, fat man sitting on a little stool, what's the expectation? Fat man sitting on a little stool takes my money all over you, right? That's the expectation, is that we're going to have another line that length. But instead he goes, takes money from my hand. Fat man sitting on a little stool takes money from my hand while eyes take a walk. Okay, that's where the song would have stopped. But he goes, all over you. So he stretches the line out to create a massive amount of tension. You expected it to end, but it doesn't end. So right off on the second line of the song, we have created this weird asymmetrical couplet. Stool and you rhymes, But the length of the lines is really different. Fat man sitting on a little stool takes the money from my hand while his eyes take a walk all over you. Wow. Again, the boss has a massively high and sophisticated amount of PI level, doesn't he? Think of all the songs he's already written that have been massively successful. He's got experience. He's got brilliance. And he's just, you know, wow. And Robert thinks he's addressing the girl the whole time. I don't think he's addressing the girl. He's addressing the audience, and he's talking about the girl. He's talking about, you know, hey, me and the girl, we're going into this. I want you to follow me with this. Like, it does say, oh, wait a minute. It says, okay, you're right. I apologize. As we're writing, yes, you're right. You're absolutely right. Thank you, Robert. I was jumping ahead. I was jumping ahead to the end of the song. I don't want to give away the end of here. But you're right. Fat man on a little stool takes the money while his eyes take a walk all over you. Now, I mean, just takes the money from my hand while his eyes take a walk all over you. I mean, that is such an amazing, interesting line. Money from the hand while his eyes take a walk all over you. So it is me and you. Absolutely right. Hands me a ticket, smiles and whispers good luck. It says, cuddle up, angel. Cuddle up, my little dove. Now notice that he didn't stay with the takes money from my hand while his eyes take a walk all over you. He stretched that line out, but he didn't stretch it out again, right? He didn't stretch it out. He goes, he hands me a ticket, smiles and whispers good luck. Cuddle up, angel. Cuddle up, my little dove. As we ride down, baby, into this tunnel of love. We have luck, dove, and love. So we have AA, and then a brilliant three line, right? So this is a five line verse. Now, I will say that as a general sort of reference, even numbered sections have less tension and have a sense of resolve. And again, this is just in a vague reference. An odd number of lines have a tendency to have more tension, right? So when he says, fat man sitting on a little stool takes money from my hands while his eyes take a walk all over you, ooh, that's stretched out. And then hands me a ticket, smiles and whispers good luck, cuddle up, little angel, cuddle up, my little dove. You could be finished there, right? Because now we have two sets, right, of lyrics. But he goes farther. He goes, while we ride down, baby, into this tunnel of love. Now, there's a pause down there. As we ride down, baby, pause, into this tunnel of love. Ride down, baby, into this tunnel of love. So that's actually five. Hands me a ticket, smiles and whispers good luck. Cuddle up, little angel. Cuddle up, my little dove. Yeah, so those are all four. So those are two four stresses. Notice I'm counting stresses and not the unstressed syllables. Yeah. As we ride down, baby, into this tunnel of love. Love lands on the downbeat. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. We ride down, baby, into this tunnel of love on the next downbeat. So it's very pow, very punctuated to end that line on the downbeat, on the one. Boom, right? Whereas the other ones don't end on the one, they end on the four. Cuddle, hands me a ticket, smiles and whispers good luck. Here's the next downbeat. Cuddle up, little angel. Cuddle up, my little dove. As we ride down, baby, pause, into this tunnel of love. Isn't that great? So, again, wonderful way to take a lesson here. Take a lesson. You can write a song about your situation. You can use this as a template. You can say, you know, the captain hands me, the captain's standing by the desert sand, you know, he takes the something like something you would give something as you're arriving, say you're arriving in Iraq, you know, he takes something as you look around the compound, right? He hands me a rifle and sit and whispers good luck, and you walk off into a country of dust, into the horizon of dust, as we ride down, you know, headed for, you know, again, you'd have to rhyme, an Iraqi or Afghanistan city that, you know, that rhymes, to get that three rhyme. So you can, my point being is you can use this as a template, you know, to write a song about your experiences, right? Okay, now let's, so did we cover everything? Yeah, so we have hands me a ticket, smiles and whispers good luck. Cuddle up, little angel. Cuddle up, my little dove. So he's talking to her at that point. Thank you, Robert. And we'll ride down, baby, into this tunnel of love. So we have the ticket, you know, these great images, absolutely wonderful images where, you know, and I like that he talks, hands me a ticket, smiles, and whispers good luck. That's it. We've talked about that many times, but having a little bit of conversation in a section is really nice. It really gives, again, contrast. We're describing, we're having actions, and then suddenly we have a little conversation. That little bit of contrast is a real sprinkling of interest, isn't it? Yes, it is. And then he says to her, cuddle up, angel, cuddle up, my little dove. Notice the repeating of cuddle and cuddle. Repeating, right? Very nice. And repeat is a fun way to extend a line, by the way. Like you could go, fat man sitting on a little stool. I paused, fat man sitting, pause, sitting on a little stool. You can always use those little inside the line repeats to stretch a line out if you need to. It's a great technique. And this is used, you know, it's not, you can't use it in prose so much. And not even in poetry, I don't know if you would do that, but that's why I love songwriting so much. Because in songwriting, you can do things you cannot do lyrically in any other form. When you're singing, you have the notes and the music, the notes, the melody, the chord, the harmonies, the texture of the instruments carrying you through. So you can do a lot more repeating than you could do in any other form of writing. It's a wonderful, wonderful thing to remember that songwriting has this ability for repetition sometimes in the oddest places, right? Keep that in mind. Little repeats in the middle, right? Okay. So we have the literal tunnel of love, right? At this point, it's literal. It doesn't stand for anything. But there is this ominous music that keeps coming. So what is going on here? Also, the guy says, whispers, good luck. Again, foreboding, isn't it? Foreboding. Okay, let's see where we go from here. We could talk a little bit about the melody. Fat man sitting on a little stool. My name is, I take a walk all over you. And whisper good luck. Cuddle up, my little angel, cuddle up, my little dove. Ride down, baby, into this tunnel of love. So very, very repetitive, isn't it? The melody is very repetitive. But the chords are changing underneath it. So, you know, it's really, you know, it's really great. I haven't learned the chords yet, but... Bad man sitting on a little stool. Man takes hand right now. Take a walk all over you. Said, wouldn't have whisper good luck. Right now, see, I can change the chords. I don't know exactly what the chords are, but you can see how I can sing the same melody and I can be playing all different chords with it. And that keeps that melody. So you have two things going on. You have the repetition of the melody driving you insane, but you have the chords changing, which saves you from insanity, right? So you have a joyous insanity, right? Not sure the chords. I should have looked it up ahead of time, but anyway, you're getting the idea, right? You're getting the idea. So we have this repetitive melody, and it's also a bluesy melody, which again has a sense of urgency, a sense of sadness, a sense of watch outness, sort of, you know? Yeah. So same melody driving you crazy, different chords under it, which keeps it interesting, right? Okay, let's now go to the next verse. Now, notice that in the second verse, in Bruce's brilliance, he decided not to do that long second line. Takes my money from my hand while his eyes take a walk all over you. Bing! Right? Doesn't do that. I can feel the soft silk, pause, of your blouse. I know, three of us, right? That's right. That's right. And that is the beginning of the transition into, oh, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Maybe this song is not about just this ride on this day, in this moment. Maybe there's a bigger thing going on. So I can feel the soft silk. What is that? An alliteration. I can feel the soft silk of your blouse. Now, about alliterations, I've always thought, and correct me if I'm wrong, or don't correct me if I'm wrong, as one politician might say. Oh my God, look what I just saw. We're going to talk about alliteration, okay? Hold that place. Alliteration. Keep saying that over and over again. Alliteration. Okay, we're warming up. We're warming up my plasma, right? I'm going to put it in my arm here and turn the little knob up to full, right? Yeah. Coffee time, the old corral. So, I can feel the soft silk. Anytime I have a word in a line that I'm not totally crazy about, or even if I am crazy about it, I will look inside a line to see if I can find another word that does one of two things. It either has the same opening letter, like soft, silk, that's same opening letter, or I could go soft cloth, right? That's an inner rhyme. Or soft collar, right? So they didn't rhyme, but the ah and the ah, that's that is a there's alliteration, and what's the other thing? Why have I forgotten that? Hold on, I've got my alliteration and God, having another brain fart. I hate it when I have brain farts. Where did I put that? It must be way in the back here. Oh, I can't find it. I know, really. Alliteration and assonance. Jesus. You know, it's been a while since I've been in class, so I forgot assonance. Let me write that down here. You know, we teachers, sometimes we have to learn, too. So it's called an assonance. When you just have a similar vowel sound, but they don't rhyme. Oh, that's so good. Oh, my God. Okay, so here we go. I can feel the soft silk of your blouse. And then soft thrills. Ah, see the contrast? We have soft silk, which is a real thing, and then we go into the symbolic world, the soft thrills, right? That's the emotional world, rather, of our little funhouse. What do they mean by our little funhouse? Very interesting. They don't own that funhouse, so we're beginning to see what's going on. So we know that at the onset of the song, Bruce knew this was going to be a symbol for something bigger, right? He knew it. So he's thinking about how am I going to drop the hints, right? The breadcrumbs to the trail. He doesn't dump, right, a sack full of boulders. No. It's the breadcrumbs, the little bits, parceling out the details. I love that word, parceling out the details, right? Parcel. Great, great word. Letting them unfold slowly, keeping your interest, not using too many at one time. We want to parcel them out to keep the arc of interest rising, rising, rising until finally at the end. All right, so our little funhouse. Funny, our little funhouse. Then the lights go out, and it's just the three of us. Wait a minute. Oh, I get it. You, me, and the little cart that we're in, right? Well, let's see. You and me and that stuff we're so scared of. And notice that when he goes to of, he sings up. That's the highest note in that verse. Let's listen to that. You, me, and all that stuff. So scared of. I love that. I love that. That's the highest note we've heard in the song so far. And notice it's towards the end of the second verse. Gotta ride down, baby. We gotta do this? We gotta ride down, baby, into this tunnel of love. So at this point, if I've been paying attention to the lyrics, I never listen to lyrics that much. I'm what we call a groove listener. There's two kinds of listeners in this world. There's groove listeners, which listen to the whole song, the melody, the chords, the texture, the everything, and the lyrics too, but not focused on it. But my sweet bride, Deanna, she can, she gets the lyric on the first listen. You know, she's a lyric listener. So she's amazing that way. At any rate, so if you're listening like she would, she knows at this point, wow, this means something more, right? So now Tunnel of Love has become a symbol, right? But at the same time, we're using real things in the real world. And that's the brilliance of Springsteen in this song, is that he's not getting corny with his supportive lines that support this Tunnel of Love symbol. The reason why they don't get corny is because this is really happening. And so the fact that it's really happening is so wonderful, in that you can get all the details of the funhouse and how they feel about it, and you get two meanings. And that's all right. So let's read on. Let's check out the bridge. Now, we know this isn't a chorus, this is a bridge. Okay, whoa. What's the first thing I notice is there is a change of the chord structure. The chords are completely new and different, and hence the melody is also a little different. He's hitting notes that he hasn't been concentrating on before, all right? So there's quite a bit of contrast there, right? Quite a bit of interest rising, isn't it? Yes, the contrast created interest, right? Now, he does use the same line length, so we do have a sense of familiarity. There's a crazy mirror showing us both in 3D. I'm laughing at you, you're laughing at me. I can feel the soft silk of your blouse and them soft thrills in our little funhouse. So you see, it's the same line length, so we do have some repetition in the line length. But wow, he changes the chords. He's got some brand new chords in there that we have not heard before at all. And I wonder how quickly I can get the chords to this song. Let me just take a little break here and let me go get the chords, make sure I don't lose this chat. Let's see, we want to get a Tunnel of Love, T-U-N-N-E-L, of Love, chords, Tunnel of Love, chords, and capo. All right, that's fine, whatever. Tunnel of Love, chords. Oh no, wrong Tunnel of Love. You know what Tunnel of Love that is? That's Dire Straits has a great song. Oh, wonderful song. Absolutely fantastic. Okay, here's the chords. And what I'm going to do is print this real quick. Let's see if I can print this and see if that'll let. Here we go. Okay, we're going to print this. So, and I apologize. I should have done this ahead of time. But, you know, I got a lot of stuff going on here, and sometimes I don't have time to do everything I want to do. All right, here it comes. Printing. Let me go back to the chat. And you're still there, thank God. All right. We don't want that chat to disappear. I've had that happen before, and that's not fun when the chat disappears. All right. And while we're waiting for it to print out, I might say, you know, in our great wealth as veterans, because the U.S. government has given us so much money for being a soldier that we're filthy rich in retirement. So we're asking you, filthy rich people out there, to donate to CreatiVets.org. CreatiVets.org. Could you do it? Could you? Okay. Well, let's just see. Let's see what the bridge does. Uh-oh. That's weird. It didn't print the bridge. For some reason. Well, that sucks. That's what I wanted to get, was the bridge. Damn. I'm sorry. Chord diagram. I wonder what happened. Let me go back and just see if I can print that. It must be a separate page that didn't print. Let me see. Okay, I'll just look at this. I'll look at it online. The heck with this. I can't see your comments right now because I'm on another page, but let me go. Okay, I can feel soft silk, B flat of your blouse, and then. So it opens, so this is C, G, B flat, F. That's the chord, that's the verse. So he opens the bridge, he goes right to the B flat, which is the flat 7. So there's the 1, there's the 7, we're going backwards. So this would be 8, 7, flat 7s, that's the B flat. Crazy mirror showing us both in 3D. We're laughing at you and we're laughing at me. So that's flat 7 to the 4 to the 5 to the 4. So you see this pattern's quite different than flat. Now check this out. Oh man, there's the. That is the. That is the honey spot right there. That's the money shot, as we say. It's easy for two people to lose each other in this tunnel of love. So the pattern is 1 to the 5, flat 7 to the 4, right? And then, like I said, in the bridge, laughing at you and laughing at me. it so hard, brothers. Easy for two people to lose each other in this town of love. You know? Really nice, really nice. All right, let me go back to the chat, see if we've made any comments here. All right. So that's what's going on there. Sharpness up and moving over again. All right. So there's quite a bit of contrast. And when you hit that A minor, whoa, we've never heard that chord before. So a wonderful lesson there is, you know, like, where are we in the song? Well, we're quite a ways down, aren't we? We've got two verses, and we're at the end of the bridge section. Nice place to give again. We're trying to keep that timeline of interest rising. We don't want it to level off. So he did change the chord structure to begin, and then we're kind of getting used to that chord structure. And then he hits that A minor and pow, man. Wow. That just sparkles musically, that spot, right? Just brilliant, brilliant. Let's look at the lyrics now. There's a crazy mirror showing us both in 3D. I'm laughing at you, you're laughing at me. Wow, well, things are pretty happy. Kind of like regular love, right? When you fall in love, everything's wonderful, right? Yeah, when you first fall, everything's just peaches and cream, right? There's a room of shadows that gets so dark, brother. Brother being an expression. It's easy for two people to lose each other. Okay. There's so much going on there. First of all, it took a turn, right? Right? We're always trying to keep momentum going. In a song, we keep momentum by doing one of two things. Either move the song forward with details, unique details, or deep, up or down, deep love or deep foreboding with emotions, right? So we can move it this way or we can move it this way. Either way, it's movement, right? So we can move the story forward, and then in the middle of a story, we can throw in emotions. And the key here is compelling emotions, right? We always want everything to be compelling, bigger than life, right? Okay, so there's a room full of shadows that gets so dark, brother. And boy, there's ominous there. And what else is there? Brother, a feminine ending, not a masculine ending. Everything in this song has been masculine. Your blouse, fun house, three of us, stool, over you, good luck, little dove, tunnel of love. Those all, the accent is on the last syllable on all those, but brother has dangling out there, right? Brother. It's easy for two people to lose each other. Jother. Feminine endings. Feminine endings create tension. Oh, shut up. So, do we need any more tension in this song? Apparently so. You know, it's like the mic drop, boom. And then he ends with, in this tunnel of love. So he resolves the feminine endings with the masculine endings. Because feminine endings are begging to be resolved. So when I go, ba-dump, 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 ba-da-da, da-da, ba-dump, 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 ba-dump. Right? We want to hear it resolve. We want to hear it resolve. So when he keeps going, ba-dump, 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 ba-da-da, dump, ba-dump, ba-dump, ba-da-da, he's increasing the tension there. And then finally, in this tunnel of love, da-da-da-da-da-ba. Oh, whew. He did. He didn't have to say, by the way, I will tell you this. You don't have to say the title in the bridge. He could have left it there. It's easy for two people to lose each other. He could have done that, but he decided, you know what? I'm going to resolve it. I'm going to let it be resolved, and I'm going to resolve it with what? The title. Awesome, right? Now we know from those last two lines, we know for absolute sure that this is a symbol. It is what we call an analogy, right? Isn't that what we call it? I believe so. Yeah. It's an analogy. And that is where it's a composition in which an idea or a thing is... Oh, no, not analogy. I'm sorry. It's an allegory. This is an allegory. All right? An allegory, and these words... I don't really pay attention to them. I just know what it is. An allegory is a complete narrative which involves characters and events that stand for an abstract concept, right? So we know now for sure this is an allegory, right? Yeah. Okay, good. So we have an allegory here, absolutely for sure, in this tunnel of love. So now, here we are in this tunnel of love. We're going through it. We're getting scared. We have the physical actually going through it, and we have the double inner meaning of this is what love is like, right? Now, we know from the structure of this non-chorus structure, we know there's going to be another verse. So, are we going to continue our ride and get out and maybe look at each other and go, wow, what just happened? Did you enjoy yourself? Yeah, I did. Although, but I was scared in this and that. Okay, let's see. Let's see if he continues the story. Let's see if he continues the story. We're going to jump because there's a long lead here. Notice the chord structure is different here. We've never heard this before. All different. Again, keeping that rising, right? A little musical interlude. Oh my God. Did we continue with the story? No. What did we do? Bruce said, you know what? I'm just going to spill my guts. I'm going to tell everybody what I've been talking about. And I'm going to do it in a very eloquent and poetic way, right? And that was important. His eloquence as a poet was important to pull this off, right? So he opens with, it ought to be easy. It ought to be. Notice ought to be and ought to be repetition. Ought to be easy. Ought to be simple enough. Boy meets woman and they, pause, fall in love. But the house is haunted and the ride gets rough. Whoa. Do you see where this is going? He just says, man, things get rough. It's not easy to maintain a love, right? And, you know, in many cases, I've heard that it isn't easy. As far as Deanna and I goes, it's the simplest thing in the universe to maintain love because, well, she's perfect. What can I say? And I adore perfection every day and every minute of my life. So I got no complaints. So Mammy's woman, they fall in love, but the house is haunted and the ride gets rough. And you got to learn to live with what you can't. Notice he goes, with what you can't, with what you can't. I love that. But that nice little bit of it, that little machine gun of beating what you can't. Rise above. And notice rise above. He goes up on that note as just the same as we're so scared of. Rises up on that one. Above. Nice. Rise above. Right? Ride gets rough. You got to learn to live with what you can't rise above. Wow. So he's saying, you got to live with love and its many deep flaws, right? Ouch. And I guess, you know, a lot of people relate to that. They go, yeah. Keeping a relationship is tough. It's not easy. You got to work on it, you know. If you want to ride down through this tunnel of love. So at this point, he's left the story, and he's now giving us what I would call conclusive writing, right? Here's a conclusion. It ought to be easy, ought to be simple enough. Man meets woman, they fall in love. That's a conclusion based on what we've heard, right? Now, but here's the thing you need to know about this falling in love thing. The house is haunted and the ride gets rough. Again, connecting with that tunnel of love thing. But notice how he connects in a very real and truthful and sincere way. You really feel like this is coming from the deepest well of his heart, right? You don't feel like this is corny. You don't feel like it's melodramatic. You feel like, wow, man, he means this. He is telling a truth here. He is honest and sincere. And he's using this allegory as a way, as a gentle way of saying, hey, love is like a funhouse. Parts of it are fun, parts of it are haunted, right? That's the tunnel of love. That is the tunnel of love. One of his best songs, one of his very, very best songs. You can't learn to live, you got to learn to live with what you can't, rise above if you want to ride down. Ride in through this tunnel of, I like in through this tunnel of love. Fucking brilliant. I mean, just wow. All right. Well, unfortunately, kids, our time is up for the day. And I've got to get on with my life. Get on with my life. And I want to thank each and every one of you in joining me for this most brilliant song. When we come back on, is today Friday? Oh God, Friday already. When we come back on Monday, we're going to talk about the song The River written by Victoria Shaw and the inevitable and incredible Mr. Garth Brooks wrote this song together. And we will talk about that song, which has a whole other thing going on there. And we'll get into that. And I hope you will enjoy Tuesday's conversaciones about the river. All right? Okay. Until we meet again, keep it on the double nickel. I'll see you on the flip-flop. Adios, amigos.